Well, so good afternoon all. Today we are going to start third simulation study and also the last one, design of a patch antenna. So till now, whatever we designed, it not radiating structure. So this is the first time we are going to design a radiating structure. Well, so this is a patch antenna in printed circuit board technology, and you can see how it looks. We have a top radiating patch which is shown in dark color, and below we have the ground plane. So it comes from two layer PCB, both sided copper PCB substrate. So a part of the top layer copper is etched away to realize the structure, and the bottom layer metal, it remains as it is. Well, so then we defined several parameters here. Ground plane size, for example, this is one important parameter. Then the dimension of this patch, it looks like a rectangle represented by W and L. L is the length. So what determines this L, W, or the ground plane size, or let's say this L1, inset fit? So we are going to discuss this point. And last week it was suggested that you should learn antenna parameters, like what is radiation pattern, what is E plane, H plane, near field, radiation efficiency, antenna efficiency, what is gain of an antenna, directivity of an antenna, beam width of an antenna. So you see, even though it is a single port device, so we are having just one port, but since it's radiating, so we have a set of parameters to define or characterize this radiation properties. So you should learn those parameters. Well, so let us start with a very simple dipole antenna. As you can see, it is basically length of 2 wires, and it can be of different sizes. In electromagnetic theory, most probably you have learned Hertzian dipole, where the arm length is much smaller compared to lambda, operating wavelength. Here we are considering a half wave dipole. So together, its dimension is half wavelength. Well, so let us first define and see some of these parameters, and then we'll compare these parameters for the dipole as well as for the patch antenna. Well, so you know that for a dipole antenna, when it radiates in space, then in one plane it looks like figure of 8, and in another plane this radiation, it looks like a circle. So what is this? This is actually the radiation pattern. So for antenna, we want to direct electromagnetic wave in the desired direction, right? So in some application, it should be more focused to one point, let's say when you have a transmitter and a receiver far away, and we don't have any other receiver, so I want to direct my power only in one direction. But there can be some other applications where we need to radiate in more than one direction, over a wide angle. So dipole is an example where radiation is coming over a wide angle. And this is a plot of radiated power versus angle. Now, what is E plane and what is H plane? Okay, before that, what are the parameters we have listed here? One is far field range, then antenna efficiency. So you are supposed to know these parameters. So just let us discuss in brief. What is far field? So in theory class, one day we are discussing that near a resonator, we may have two different types of field components. For one field components, electric field and magnetic field, they are in phase quadrature. And another field component for which electric field and magnetic field, they are in the same phase. Now, if you move away from antenna, that the phase quadrature component, it can't propagate through free space. So it lies with the antenna, in the vicinity of antenna. So the region over which this propagating wave dominates, basically, we call it far field range. So for most of the antennas, people define a distance R. It should be more than twice d square by lambda naught. D is the longest dimension of your antenna. If it's a patch, you consider diagonal distance. Then a region for which distance is more than this value, we'll be considering it far field range of that antenna. Now you are fitting some power to antenna. A part is reflected back from the pole, and a part is accepted by the antenna. Now, whatever power accepted by the antenna, a part of that, it radiates into space. And what about the remaining part? It is wasted inside the structure itself. How come wasted? You know already in PCB technology, for example, we may have conductor loss, dielectric loss. So finally, they will generate heat. Other than that, we may also have surface wave loss. So surface wave loss, we have another type of problem. Surface wave, it propagates along the surface of your dielectric layer. Now consider for this patch antenna. So let's say it's exciting surface wave in all the direction. It will travel through this dielectric, and finally, at this dielectric air boundary, it radiates. Over this radiation, we don't have any control. This is given by the geometry of ground plane, dielectric material, and other things. So it comes out as undesired radiation. Let's say you want to radiate power in a given direction, but in addition to that, we have this undesired radiation in the form of surface wave, from the surface wave. Well, so we don't want this surface wave excitation. That will be considering as wastage of power. Well, so basically what we see then, that whatever power antenna is accepting, all of that, it is not radiating. Only a part it is radiating. So if it could radiate all of this power which it is accepted, then we call antenna efficiency 100%. But because of loss and other things, it decreases. There is one more term, radiation efficiency. You learn it. Most of the cases, for most of the cases, you will find answer from simply Google search. Or you go through any antenna, standard antenna textbook. You learn about what is directivity, what is gain. So it is also defined here. So in the gain, actually, we consider loss in the antenna structure. Well, so this gain parameter or antenna efficiency, it is one of the most important parameters for an antenna. Why? Let us consider this antenna. So here you can see we have a microstrip feed line. Now, if I just measure S parameters, it is a 1-port device. So we have S11 at this port. Now, if S11 is sufficiently low, let's say minus 15 dB or minus 20 dB. So that means most of the power is accepted by the device itself. But just from that, we can't conclude that it is an antenna. Why? It can be a mass load, mass termination. That can also absorb power. So then you see, S11, that is one essential criteria or essential parameter, but not sufficient. In addition to that, you need some parameters which characterizes its radiation. So that's why for any antenna, when you specify its characteristics, So two most important parameters, one is the gain plot, another one is the S11 plot. There are many more, but these two are the most important parameters of an antenna. Remember that. Gain plot, gain versus frequency or gain versus angle, and then S11 variation with frequency. These two are most important parameters of an antenna. Well, now we know what is radiation pattern, then what is E plane and what is H plane. So with respect to dipole antenna, we can define it. You see, this dipole antenna, if its orientation is like this, then in which direction it will radiate and what will be the direction of electric field? Well, so by the direction of electric field, we determine polarization, right? So electric field, radiated electric field, it will be parallel to this wire arm. Let us use some coordinate system better. So let's say one coordinate system is defined here. Let's say you placed your dipole antenna here on z axis. So arm there along z. Then on xy plane, radiated electric field is perpendicular. Try to understand. The antenna arm, it is along z, and radiated electric fields are parallel to this antenna arm, dipole. So on xy plane, which is perpendicular to z, electric field will be also perpendicular because electric field, it is in z direction. If I consider yz plane, then electric field is parallel to this plane, or we can say yz plane or zx plane contains electric field. Electric field is parallel to that. Well, so now how we define E plane and H plane pattern? We have to consider the direction of maximum radiation. Now consider a plane that contains the direction of maximum radiation as well as electric field. We call it E plane. So on E plane, then electric field will be parallel, and it will also contain the direction of maximum radiation. H plane, just perpendicular to it. So it will contain the magnetic field and direction of maximum radiation. That is your H plane. So for dipole antenna, then which one is E plane, which one is H plane? If I put the dipole along Z, then you see along XY, on the XY plane, we have actually maximum radiation. So it can be along X, along Y, it is same in all direction. So we can consider either ZX plane or ZY plane. So both of them contains the direction of maximum radiation as well as electric field. Electric field is parallel to Z. So if I draw radiation pattern, angle versus, let's say, E square, then ZX or YZ plane is the E plane, and on this plane we will get figure of H, because the antenna along the arm direction in Z direction, it does not radiate anything. So along Z we have null or zero radiation, and on XY plane it will have highest radiation. So we have figure of H, that is the E plane. What about H plane? Electric field is propagating magnetic field or H field that is perpendicular to electric field. You consider that propagation direction, electric field and magnetic field direction, they fits in a right-handed orthogonal system. They are perpendicular to each other. So for this case, then the radiation, it is in XY plane, it's propagating along Y, minus Y, plus X, minus X, on this plane basically. So magnetic field it should be in this plane. Then xy plane defines the H plane. And since in all direction radiation intensity same on this plane, we have a circle. So now you look here. E plane pattern is figure of 8. So in the direction of the arm, you don't have any radiation, maximum radiation in perpendicular direction. And for the H plane, it is on the XY plane, it is radiating equally in all directions. This is for a dipole antenna, half-wave dipole antenna. Well, now what about the patch? Well, for patch antenna, radiation comes out perpendicular to the screen. So patch is lying on XY plane. Then radiation will be along Z, positive Z, according to this figure. And what is the direction of electric field? The electric field, it will be along Y. So even though we have two edges, one is defined by W, which is in X direction, this one and this one, and another set defined by L, we have radiation only from this W side, parallel to X, top edge, bottom edge, and the electric field is perpendicular in Y direction. Okay, so if that is the scenario and radiation mostly coming out in positive Z, so can you, one of you, switch on your microphone and tell me what should be the E plane, what should be the H plane? One of you, please switch on your microphone and tell me which one is E plane, which one is
Y-Z
H plane.
Is E plane. Y-Z is E plane.
YJ E plane, yes. And H plane?
YXZ.
Yeah, ZX plane. So it should, why not XY plane? Because it should also contain direction of maximum radiation. So we can't avoid Z axis, right? So that's why XY plane is of no interest. So since radiation mostly comes out in positive Z direction, now we have to consider Z axis and the plane for which magnetic field is parallel. So that is ZX plane. All of you understood, or you can switch on your microphone and ask me.
Understood, sir.
Okay, good. Then I'm assuming that all of you understood. Now we have to understand about impedance matching, and we can also explain why it should radiate along W only. Well, so impedance matching means we want to transfer maximum power from feed point to your antenna. Antenna should accept maximum power. So if input in microstrip line, it has the characteristics impedance of 50 ohm, then at the input where it is touching the antenna, looking into the antenna, input impedance should be 50 ohm. What about the imaginary part? Can you switch on and tell me?
Zero.
Yes, exactly. Zero. So it is a resonant antenna. We have two types of antennas. One set based on resonators, basically leaky resonators. And second set, traveling wave. Traveling wave, right now we are not covering. Horn antenna, then Vivaldi antenna. Well, so here all of them are resonator based. Dipole also half wavelength resonator. dispatch antenna L, that is also half wave length only. Now, do you remember, for a half wavelength transmission line resonator, we can also implement it in microstrip lines. What is the input impedance at the open end? For a half wavelength transmission line resonator, what is the input impedance at open end?
Z naught.
How come?
ZL.
So it is a transmission line resonator. Consider about voltage and current distribution. At the open end, it is open circuited. Then simple transmission line resonator. Consider fundamental resonance. So we have electric field maxima at the end. Our corresponding voltage for TEM case we can define. It is maximum. What about current? Open end current is zero. It is maximum high. So this is for current and highest at the center. And this one is the voltage or electric E dot DL A to D, that will give the voltage. Anyway, so I am saying here that was one of the conditions to remember. You recall that using that condition, we found out resonant condition for dual band resonator. So Zin at this point is equal to what?
Sir, infinity.
Exactly. For ideal lossless resonator, it is infinity. And on this plane, Zin, if it is lossless resonator, then Zin. What?
Zero.
But if it is lossy, we have a finite value. Anyway, that is the minimum value. I am using that same concept here, a microstrip line resonator now. Microstrip line resonator. Then if I feed here, connect 50 ohm line here directly, then input impedance is infinite. If I connect here, then it is minimum. So basically then 50 ohm point, I can say it will be somewhere in between, right? That 50 ohm impedance point, somewhere in between. So what we can do, let's say this is your resonating patch, like little wider W I'm considering. This is W and this is L. So for half wavelength resonator, now you already know L should be lambda G by 2, half wavelength. Now, as I know on the central plane, it is minimum, open circuit plane maximum. So somewhere here, I can connect my 50 ohm line. Here I'll be connecting my port, and then I can tune this distance L1 and find out what is the optimum L1 for minimum S11. So this is the port. Okay. So that can be one technique. I can connect microstrip line like this. And then on this plane, we have electric field maxima. This plane electric field maxima. And here it will vary sinusoidal. Well, instead of that, here we are using the same concept, but we are using inset field. What that means, I'm cutting the microstrip line here. And this distance L1, so this is another type of fit configuration. We call it inset fit, as shown in that figure. So then now you understood why I should cut it, right? And now what you have to do? You have to basically tune L1 now for better impedance matching. Right? This point, till this point, do you have any question?
Sir, please explain why we are inset fitting. You
can also do it in this direction. So this is just one technique, that's all. We can also, we could connect it here. So depending on your application requirement, it can be, you can have many of the antennas to design array antenna and other things. So depending on application requirement, any one of them you can use. Not that always you have to use this inset fit.
Sir, in both the cases, E and H planes wouldn't be different.
No, because L is fixed, direction of radiation is fixed. I'm coming to that. Why? It radiates from W side. That is fixed. I'm exciting along L. So L is defined by L is equal to lambda G by 2. Okay, so whatever may be fitting technique, but resonant condition remains same. It is along L. We have maxima on leftmost edge and rightmost edge. That is fixed. We can also use coaxial feed. So usually people use one SMA connector. You already know what is SMA connector. And below the ground, they will insert SMA. So it is somewhat like this. If I plot the side view, let's say this is your top patch. This is your ground plane. So then they will etch a part here. Well, this is your ground plane. So it's a more circular aperture, and then the outer metal of the coax, they will connect to ground, and the inner one goes up and soldered here. That is another technique. And this is the subset, the side view. So this is L. And again, this one is the same, L1. Okay, you just, this L1 remains same from left side to this hit point distance. And it is done along the center line. Coaxial fitting. There are different fitting techniques. So we'll be using as given in the main one. For now. Well, now let me explain why W side radiates.
Sir, one thing, sir, the L1 will tune by hand, right? Like the L1 parameter?
We have some closed form expression for that. Our thumb rule is 1/3 of L you take, and then with respect to that point, you tune it using your Fourier accelerator.
Okay, sir.
Previously, when full-wave simulation was not available 30 years back, antenna design itself, it could take a few months. And now it became just a few hours problem. If you know HFSS property, then you can design your antenna just in 1 hour. Well, So why alarm W? Let's start with a simple microstrip line, its electric field configuration. So which view I drew here? It is cross-sectional view of the microstrip line, right? Now, what about the electric field orientation? We have perpendicular electric field component. Already you learned from theory class. And here, we have the fringing field components. So this fringing field actually, radiation comes out from this fringing. Now here we have a problem. This part of the fringing field, bent part, I can divide it into two components. One perpendicular, one horizontal components. So let's say this is the eject component. And what was the direction here? It is EX component. Right? Now, this is for the left side. What I did, I just zoomed in this part and divided this bent part into two components, horizontal component and the vertical component. Okay, now, next, we do the same thing for this part. Then here also we have EX component and EZ component. Now, if I consider radiation in Z direction, EZ component, it can't propagate in Z direction. Why? It is becoming parallel. You already solved for plane wave in electromagnetic theory class. For a wave to propagate in free space, electric field, magnetic field, they should be perpendicular to the direction of propagation. So that is not satisfied for EZ component in Z direction. Then what about EX? EX, so see we have a problem. They are canceling each other, left side and right side. So that's why from microstrip line, particularly in perpendicular direction, which is coming out from the board, we don't have as such any radiation. This EX component are canceling each other. Well, in addition to this, we need to check also that EX and HX, they are in same phase or not. Anyway, if they are in phase quadrature, no component of radiation. So what is the conclusion from this? Then from a microstrip line, as such in perpendicular direction, we don't have any radiation. Now, let us consider half wavelength resonator. Well, half wavelength resonator, first let me draw microstrip line version. A thin half wavelength resonator, this dimension is given by W. Now, electric field maxima that I know on both sides, but what about the orientation of electric field? It is opposite, right? So at this end, if electric field it is in this direction, then at this end, electric field it is in opposite direction. Then what about the fringing field component? Let us represent now by side view. So this is now the side view of microstrip. You have this top strip and this is your ground plane. Now let's see what happened to that EX component, which is due to the fringing field. One is going up, or another one, it is actually going down. If I zoom in, then we have this component and this component of EX. Now here, since it is changing its direction, EX, we have in same direction. So what we conclude then from this half wavelength resonator, from the ends, we have EX component in the same direction, So we can have radiation in z direction, for which electric field will be in x direction. So here, then from these two edges, we have radiation. What about these two edges? It is like a microstrip line. So left side, right side, electric field in same direction, and for the fringing field, it will cancel each other. Well, this side we represented by Ex. For microstrip line, this side we represented by Ex. X, then let us represent it by Y, not to be confused with direction. Let us represent it by EY. While so radiation in the Z direction, it is coming from EY component. And from EX component, we don't have any radiation. Am I clear till this point? Did you understand why a half wavelength resonator radiates from its end? Well, good. Now I want to increase radiation. I have to increase W. It will increase your radiation aperture. So that's why you see W is higher here. Typically, we take W more than L. But if we keep on increasing W, there are other issues. We can have higher order mode along W. Just to consider for rectangular waveguide, TE10, TE01 mode. Here also now, instead of resonating along L, it can start resonating along W. So we have to avoid that. Also, when we use an antenna, particularly linearly polarized antenna, we want radiated electric field only in one direction. Let me give you one example. Let's say you have a radio transmitter, your AM or FM radio. Now, if the electric field is parallel to Earth surface, then it is attenuated by Earth surface. Earth surface has small but finite conductivity, so it will attenuate electric field. Then for this radio transmitter, what is the direction we want? Vertical. Electric field should be perpendicular to Earth surface. So if I use a dipole transmitter, I will be using dipole in vertical direction. And practically what happens? Ideally, a dipole, vertical dipole, should provide electric field only in vertical direction. But practically, we have a small component of electric field in horizontal component. That is the undesired radiation. So the desired radiation, we call it copolar radiation, or simply copole radiation. And this undesired radiation, we call crosspolar radiation, or simply crosspole radiation, COL, crosspole radiation, or cross-polarized component. Well, so if the dipole it is vertically placed, then the horizontal component is the unwanted component of that cross-pole component. Then what about the patch antenna? For a patch antenna in H plane, well, let me go back. Well, you can see it now. You already know which one is E plane, which one is H plane. Electric field is parallel to Y, so YZ is the E plane, and this is the desired radiation on E plane. Now, in HFSS and also in measurement, we can measure cross-pole component. What we'll be doing, we'll be measuring on E plane only, but we'll change the receiving antenna direction by 90 degree and we'll see what is the received power. Ideally, it should be zero. So basically, on YZ plane, what is the radiating electric field in X direction? That is the undesired component that we measure, but on YZ plane. that will give you cross-polar radiation pattern, cross-pole radiation, angle versus this component. Similarly, that the desired component on YZ plane, that will give you the copole radiation pattern. Okay, so copole, cross-pole. Similarly, we can define also same thing on H plane. Well, some other parameters. This is a highly directive antenna. You can see this is the main lobe and a part is coming backward direction also. So all these undesired lobes are called side lobes. This one is the back lobe. And for the main beam, sometimes we define beam width just to understand how directive the antenna is. So what we do, typically one figure 3 dB beam width is popular. So you note down what is the direction of maximum radiation and what is the gain value at that point. Let's say it's coming 5 dBi. We always represent gain with respect to some reference antenna. So usually if nothing is specified, it is with respect to one isotropic radiator, which radiates equally in all directions. Anyway, so let's say it is 5 dBi, then we come up and down, where gain is down by 3 dB, that is 2 dBi, and then measure what is the angular distance between this. That will give you 3 dB beam width of the antenna. Now in the simulation, then what you have to do? So initial parameters, how to start simulation, that is given here. Go through it and follow it. Then you have to show return loss, and then from that you show what is the 10 dB matching bandwidth. If you design an antenna at 2.4 gigahertz, let's say at 2.4 gigahertz S101 is going down to minus 30 dB. Now for application, let's say minus 10 dB matching point is enough. So we then check minus 10 dB point, left hand side below 2.4 gigahertz and above 2.4 gigahertz. And that we define as 10 dB bandwidth is defined. So you have to show that. And if you are asked to design at 2.4 gigahertz, note it down. If you are asked to design at 2.4 gigahertz, you don't have to show from 0.1 to 5 gigahertz like this wide frequency band. We don't have any information. 10 dB bandwidth, let's say if it is 2.3 to 2.5, I think 2.2 to 2.6 frequency range should be enough. So plot your S11 over this narrow frequency band so that it includes your 10 dB point, not more than that. Then plot three-dimensional radiation pattern. Well, in HFSS, you will see that there are actually many terms related to gain. You do Google search or go through HFSS manual, because in your MCQ, you will ask what are the meaning of these different gains. What is realized gain? What is simply gain? Okay, so what is left-hand circularly polarized gain? There are many terms you will see. You should understand the meaning of each and every term. Then plot realized gain pattern. So you directly plot the gain pattern, that is gain versus frequency in E plane and in H plane. 3 dB beamwidth, and hence you show 3 dB beamwidth. So you also have to plot copole and cross pole pattern. So basically together we have four patterns, two cross pole patterns on E and H planes, and two copole patterns on these two planes. Well, in addition to these, I am giving you one more work. You note it down, please. It is suggested here you take W equal to 1.25 times of L. In addition to that, you also consider Okay, for another group, I gave value 1 and 1.5. So for you, it is 0.8 times up L. Write it down. You have to repeat it for two more cases. The first case, case 1, you write down W equal to 1.25 L. Case 2, W equal to 0.8 L. And case 3, W equal to 1.7 L. 1.7 L. So you have to repeat all this calculation part for these three different cases. So you will understand why we should optimize W with respect to L. Cross-pull pattern will increase and there will be some other issues. Till this point, do you have the, yeah.
So can you repeat the values again? W.
Okay, I can't edit PDF here. I'm sharing. You do for W equal to 0.8 L, 1.25 L, 1.7 times of L. Another three sets actually I defined for another two. And TS, please note it down. You will be allotting them epsilon r, so basically substrate. And design frequency. So 1 gigahertz. Substrate parameters and the design frequency. So design frequency you keep between 1 to 10 because at higher frequencies they make space problem. And for 10 gigahertz you take 0.508 millimeter or something similar to that. At 1 gigahertz you can give them 1.6 millimeter or something similar to that. And in between you choose help accordingly. Otherwise they can face problem. So TS, please note it down. You can maximum give one set to three students. One set to three students. So for example, 2.4 gigahertz antenna, you can give to 9 students for each three for 1.787 millimeter thick RTD right 5880. Then for another group, 0.5084003C, like that. Okay, so you change the parameters. Well, students, if you have any question. Okay, Professor Mohan is also here. Professor Mohan, if you want to share any other point.
No. Let them continue. Okay.
Yes, please.
Tomorrow, when we will have the quiz, that is.
Quiz actually what I am planning, 24th is holiday, no?
Yes.
Due to Puja. And we have, actually Saturday I have a class, 10:30 to 12 o'clock. So I can take it for all the three groups that time. I think okay. Only one student is there who is not attending theory. I need to email contact him separately. Otherwise, means at a common time we can give them. So 17th already they have one exam. Then okay. It is 31st of October.
31st, then we will have, we can have on 31st.
Or otherwise, we can take on any Wednesday 20, then that is also 28, because 21 we have class.
21st we can have, I think.
Okay, then 21 also we can, whatever you say.
Yeah.
21st, I will take half an hour first class and then go for exam.
At what time it will be?
It is 8 to 10.
Okay.
And maybe I will speak to you later.
Okay, no, no problem. Yeah.
Yeah, student, one of you asking some question.
Sir, I was asking that if when we are tuning this, sir, is there any method that we can use on HFSS to tune? Because last experiment, yes, when we were tuning for single,
yeah, there is optimization you can do, but since it is your first design, I would suggest you do it manually, and it is just one parameter. Our TS will guide. Okay.
Okay.
So Joyasmita or Bhanu, Joyasmita, can you be online, please? Switch on your MIC microphone.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yeah. Do you have any ready-made antenna?
Sir, right now I'm not having, but I can design and show them. Yes, possible.
Yeah, that is so. So what I would suggest, that since they never did any radiation or radiating structure, then you show better, means that infinite sphere setup, basically simulation setup, and how it looks in polar coordinates. It's simple, using PEC also you can do it, don't take more than 15 minutes then.
Okay, sir. Okay.
Bhanu is not here, right?
Yes, sir, I'm here, sir.
Oh, yeah, Bhanu, do you have antenna or any one of you? Yeah, and any antenna, ready-made,
yes, sir,
antenna? You have,
yes, sir. It is with Niloy. Actually, my system is off, so I can ask Niloy to send it to you.
Not, yes, me. You or Joyasmita show it. Okay, or you can, yes, design, sir, in front it. Of them, because radiating structure they are doing for the first time. Yes, so you have to show the means how to set up the simulation environment, and then what are the results you are expecting. Those things, radiation,
okay,
pattern, full cross pole.
Yes, yes, sir, that will do.
Yeah, maximum 1 hour, and then you can ask it. Okay.
Yes, sir, we have the file with us, so we'll be showing them.
Yeah, so one of you please take it, take this responsibility. You and Joyce,
okay,
are doing.
Okay.
And in the meantime, other TS, so students, you can, when they are presenting, you can type your question in the chat box, then other TS will be answering to you.
Okay, sir.
Yeah,
sir, we had another request, sir. Sir, actually this week, Friday, Saturday and Thursday, a lot of us have five tests in those 3 days.
Next week.
And
next
then
week.
Another submission on Sunday.
Next week, 21st.
Sir, not about the test, but submission of this experiment, if that could be delayed to more than a week.
No. You will be given 1 week, and that is final. You see, now you are in home. You don't have other activities. And when you are here, you used to follow this routine only.
Sir,
listen to me. Listen to me. Whatever problem we are giving to you, we are not expecting it. It will take more than 3 hours, 2 to 3 hours maximum. So that you can easily manage in 1 week of time. Only 1 day I can maybe, so next Monday night I can set it like that instead of Sunday night.
Okay,
fine. Then today we are not creating any more new meeting window. So with this, Bhanu and Jayasmita will continue. So if you have any question right now, you can ask, or you can, otherwise they will start the session part.
Sir, I have a request, sir.
Last question about the last experiment. Oh, go ahead, Shashwat.
Sir, 21st October is Mahapanchami, sir. So if we could have the test, the lab test on Monday's class instead, sir, on 19th.
21st is Panchami, then 20 also we have Chaturthi, and then 19th Tritiya. It starts from 16th actually, no? And but according to IIT rule, the holiday starts on 23. So either we have to follow general Bengali sentiment, then I should start vacation from 16th or IIT rule.
So it's just a request. Sir.
So we
no,
can.
On there is nothing actually.
Hello.
So then the same logic holds for the first day, second day, third day, fourth day also. Yes, please.
I was saying that after we are done with the patch antenna, so like then we like will we have like more experiments or like are we done with the experiments? Like
you are done with simulation, then we'll start the measurement part.
We'll start the
measurement part.
Measurement part.
Sir, I had one doubt about the last week's experiment. Sir, in single stub matching, when we were giving different resistances to the stub, 25 ohms, 50 ohms, and then 100 ohms, and seeing the curves in isolation, sir, a lot of us observed that when there was when it was 50 ohms, similar to the transmission line, the bandwidth was the sharpest, and we could not actually get the exact reason for this, sir. So. Is this observation correct, and what is the theory behind
it? I did not understand. So let's say from left hand side, your feed line has a characteristic impedance of 50 ohm. Now yes. Right hand side, the load ZL, its real part is saying 50 ohm, then it is sharpest.
So no, sir, the characteristic impedance of the right side, meaning the width, when we change the width and the characteristic impedance changes from 25 to 50 to 100.
Okay, for the matching section, you are saying?
Yes, sir, yes.
Okay, yes, yes. It means if you go to higher impedance, more than 50 ohm or let's say 100 ohm, then it will be more sharper. If you come to lower side, it will be wider. So there is a reason I explained it when we explained about the open stubs properties. You recall the reactive slope. I have shown you from calculation how the capacitor is changing. You recall that?
Oh yes.
Inductor
yes.
Is changing. Yeah, the same reason here. Okay, fine. Then we are stopping here. And Bhanu or Joy Smita, you start.